In the name of Allah, our Creator, the Creator of the universe and of everything that's in it, I greet you all, dear observers, in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, blessings, and mercy be with you all. We are still discussing the issue of Islam and science, emphasizing the fact that the Holy Quran is basically a book of guidance to man in areas that cannot be clearly addressed by man, such as the area of faith, the area of acts of worship, the area of the moral code, and the area of the code of transactions with others. We repeatedly mentioned that these four basic areas cannot be correctly addressed by man, and hence the need by man for religion. And at the same time, religion cannot be tailored by man. And hence we can find a clear-cut criterion by which we can discriminate between a true religion and a false one. And this criterion is the authenticity of the revelation that was sent down with the religion. If the revelation is intact, in the exact language of revelation, has not been tampered by man, has not been infiltrated by human ideas, has not been played around with by its followers, then the religion is correct. If the revelation has been lost, has been committed to a language other than the language of revelation, has been played around by its followers, then the religion is not correct, even if it still contains some remnants of the initial truth. Religion has to be absolutely divinely revealed, without the slightest human infiltration or alteration. If we apply this criterion to all the isms of the time, we can see clearly that the only form of divine guidance to man that has been kept intact in exactly the same language of revelation, the Arabic language, preserved by the will of Allah, word to word and letter to letter, is the glorious Quran and the traditions of Muhammad, peace be upon him. Because of this, we are asked to give that guidance to as many people as we can without any imposition. Give it kindly, rationally, intelligently, because Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, has told us, if Allah can help you to save a single soul from going to hellfire, this is far better for you than this whole world and everything that's in it. Because of this, we are discussing today the issue of the forbidden food to Muslims. Why Allah has legalized certain types of food and has forbidden certain types of food for Muslims. And every divine legislation in the glorious Quran is for a great wisdom. And we shall try to seek some of that wisdom in this episode. The Quran reads, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in Surah An-Nahl. The Quran reads, إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ الْمَيْتَةَ وَالدَّمَى وَلَحْمَ الْخِنْزِيرِ وَمَا أُهِلَّ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ بِهِ فَمَنِ اضْطُرَّ غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. The verse reads, He, meaning Allah, all glory be to Him, has only forbidden to you dead animals. A Muslim cannot eat a dead animal. Blood. Shedded blood. A Muslim cannot eat a shedded blood. The flesh of a swine. Swine flesh is categorically forbidden for a Muslim, and that which has been dedicated to others than Allah, all glory be to Him. Really, we have to discuss each of these points rationally. Why does Allah forbid dead animals to be eaten by a Muslim? If an animal dies, it dies either through old age or through a disease. In both cases, if the animal has been aged enough so that it died out of old age, then its flesh can never be suitable for eating by man. Because we know that throughout growth of any living cell, the division of the chromosomes to produce a new cell minimizes the potential of these chromosomes. So that it has been proved by experimentation that young animals, the flesh of young animals, is more beneficial to human health than the flesh of an old animal. An old animal has suffered lots of chromosomal divisions, and has made the cell to be old. And old cells are very useless to the growth of the human body. If the animal died out of a disease, it will carry the sources of that disease within its flesh. And eating that flesh will carry the same disease to man. And that's why Allah has forbidden the meat of dead animals to be eaten by a Muslim. إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةَ. Allah has made it forbidden to you to eat dead animals. وَالدَّمَى. Fresh blood. Flowing blood. We know that blood carries all the waste of the body, all the diseases of the body, all the metabolic products that are released after the metabolic activity in the body. So actually, the blood carries the filth of the body, the waste of the body. So we cannot drink fresh blood. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is quoted to have said, وَحِلَّتْ لَنَا مَيْتَتَانِ وَدَمَانِ. There are two dead entities that have been made lawful for us to eat, and two types of blood. الميتتان, السمك والجراد. Anything that's coming from the sea, even if it is dead, it's allowable. A Muslim can eat it. And locust, because locust usually feeds on green material, it does not go bad easily. والدمان, the two bloods that are lawful to Muslims are الكبد والطحال, the liver and the spleen. Liver and spleen are made of blood cells, yet this is not flowing blood. It does not carry the waste of the body. So this elaboration is scientifically very precise and medically very precise as well, and can easily testify to the correct prophethood of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةَ وَالْدَّمْ. We now understand why Allah, all glory be to him, has made a dead animal unsuitable for food, and has made fresh blood, flowing blood, unsuitable as food for a good Muslim. وَلَحْمَ الْخِنْزِيرِ. The swine flesh. Probably nowadays, the spread of the swine flu can give us a lesson and show us the wisdom by which the Quran, 14 centuries ago, has made breeding swines illegal and feeding on swine flesh completely unacceptable. First of all, because the pig is a very dirty animal. Allah has created pigs not to be bred amidst human beings. Allah has created pigs as wild animals to clean the waste of life on the surface of that planet. Let them go free. Let them clean the environment from all wastes that are in it. Because pigs are made to live on waste material, on garbage, on filthy material. Allah has created them for that purpose, not to be eaten. So, being a dirty animal, the body of a pig is full of sources of diseases. Many worms, many viruses, many forms of bacteria, many forms of algae that flourish on waste, that live on waste. And Allah has given the swine body the ability to coexist with these sources of diseases. So the swine flesh is full of many sources of diseases. And if man was to eat the swine flesh, he can carry these sources of diseases to his own body. And some of these sources could be absolutely fatal. Thirdly, the pig is an omnivorous animal. The big pig is an omnivorous animal, because biologists classify animals into three categories on the basis of their way of feeding. Animals feeding on grass alone, and they call them herbivorous, and if these diseases to your own body. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is quoted to have said, أُحِلَّتْ لَنَا مَيْتَتَانِ وَدَمَانِ. There is an exception here, mentioned by Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, that two dead entities man can eat safely. That's what comes from the sea. Fish, lobster, and the like. Shrimps, and the like. And locust, because locust usually feeds on vegetation. It doesn't eat flesh, and that's why it doesn't go bad. And the man, the two bloods are the liver and the spleen. Liver and spleen are composed of blood cells. But this is not a flowing blood. It does not carry any of the waste of the body. On the contrary, both in the organs carry useful material for the human flesh. إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةَ وَالْدَّمَ وَلَحْمَ الْخِنْزِيرِ. The swine flesh. We mentioned that the pig is a dirty animal. It lives on waste material, on rubbish, on rotten material. And Allah has created pigs as a means of cleaning the environment from all the waste. So pigs cannot be bred amidst human beings, cannot be slaughtered to be given as food to human beings, because the flesh of a swine is full of many, many, many causes of diseases. Worms, viruses, bacteria, algae, germs, all, you name it. And this has been scientifically proved. And if you eat swine flesh, you are bound to bring to your own body many sources of very many different diseases. Secondly, the swine fat is an oversaturated fat. It cannot be digested by the human stomach. It cannot be stored by the human liver. It has to be accumulated in the body of those who eat swine flesh, so long they are eating it, accumulated as swine fat. And this can cause many, many diseases. Angina, blockage of the blood vessels, heart diseases, high cholesterol level in the body, many diseases. And because of this, we are forbidden from eating swine flesh or swine fat. Again, the swine flesh is not only flesh, but you can see fibers of the fat penetrating the flesh. So you cannot avoid it. Thirdly, we mentioned that the pig has got the same eating habits as the human being. Both are omnivorous. And if man eats an animal with the same feeding habits, this is bound to integrate the cycle of any disease between man and the pig. This is more complete than this cycle between man and any other animal eaten by man. There are many other reasons that can stop man from eating any of these categories which Allah has made forbidden for us. Dead animals, flowing blood, swine flesh, and finally, وَمَا أُهِلَّ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ بِهِ, or any animal that was slaughtered in the name of other than Allah, all glory be to Him. And here I will record to you a scientific experiment carried by a group of scientists in Syria. And the experiment is placed on the internet. A group of medical doctors, specialists in very many different fields of science, chemistry, biology, pharmaceuticals, many different fields, animal husbandry, and they got two goats from the same flock. And they killed one in the normal Islamic way and studied its flesh under a microscope, and killed another goat or sheep from the same flock in the Western way of killing, either by stunning through a heavy weight that falls on its head and causes it to be stunned, or by electric shocks, or by putting in a gas chamber. And they studied both fleshes, the one slaughtered according to the Islamic way and the one slaughtered according to the Western way, under the microscope. And they could prove clearly the great difference between animals slaughtered in the Islamic way and animals slaughtered in an un-Islamic way. in the un-Islamic way, the flesh of the animal, which has been killed by a non-Islamic procedure, is full of blood. And as mentioned earlier, blood carries the waste of the body, and if this waste is admixed with the flesh, it can create many, many causes of diseases. I mention this case because many of the Westerners claim that the Islamic way of killing animals is cruel, is harsh, is very, very much hurting to the feelings of the animals, and they don't know that their own way of killing is more cruel, is more harsh, more inhumane than what we are doing to animals. In Islam, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is quoted to have instructed those who slaughter animals to sharpen their knives, to hide the knives from the animal that's going to be slaughtered, not to slaughter an animal in front of another animal, and to take lots of precautions not to hurt the feelings of the animal that's being slaughtered. On the contrary, stunning the animals is causing more pain than slaughtering them in the Islamic way. Putting an animal in a gas chamber is more hurting and more cruel than slaughtering the animal in the Islamic way. I have found on internet an American medical doctor who is advising his own community and his own people to reconsider the Islamic way of slaughtering as the best way of slaughtering animals to make the flesh suitable for human eatings. From this we can see clearly that the divine instruction in Surah An-Nahl, not to eat dead animals, not to eat flowing blood, not to eat the swine flesh, not to eat an animal that has been slaughtered in the name of others than Allah, all glory be to him. These are main guidances in the area of instruction of food to Muslims, which we have to follow strictly to be saved in this world and in the world to come. Sadly enough, time is approaching to be over, and I want to talk also about forbidding drinking alcohol. And in a nutshell, I would say that alcohol is an organic solvent. Putting it into the human stomach is absolutely harmful to the human body. It can dissolve many of the organic material that are essential for the existing body of a human being. Drinking alcohol can affect seriously the nervous cells, especially the brain. And the brain is the greatest gift Allah has given man. And if you destroy your intellect, your intelligence, your own brain, you are not doing any good for yourself. Most of the road accidents in the whole world are caused by drunkards. Most of the crimes that are committed all over the world is caused by drunkards. So if Islam has forbidden alcohol and has forbidden animals eating the flesh of animals that are dead, or animals that have been slaughtered in an un-Islamic way, or eating flowing blood, or eating the swine flesh, we can see a great deal of sense and a great deal of reason behind these abstentions, these instructions from Allah to Muslims. And we have to invite others to refrain from eating harmful food such as the one that has been outlined in the glorious Quran and in the traditions of Muhammad, peace be upon him. And until another episode, we can elaborate more on related issues, inshallah. So until that time, I hope to see you again, wishing you the best and greeting you in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, blessings, and mercy be with you all.